The name of the Lord is to be praised.
Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere.
I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked.
Make me to know your ways, O Lord.
Teach me your paths.
Sanctify us in your truth.
Your word is truth.
From the rising of the sun to its setting,
the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
For to you have I committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the needy from the hand of evildoers. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading from Romans chapter 6. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been bought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Are we to sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed. And having been set free from sin, having become slaves of righteousness, I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness leading to sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. But what fruit were you getting at that time from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our third reading from the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 10. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise up against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next, for truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We continue with our catechetical readings this morning from Christian Questions with Their Answers, the final three questions. So after confession and instruction in the Ten Commandments, the Creed, the Lord's Prayer, and the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper, the pastor may ask, or Christians may ask themselves, these questions. Finally, why do you wish to go to the sacrament?
That I may learn to believe that Christ, out of great love, died for my sin, and also learn from him to love God and my neighbor.
What should admonish and encourage a Christian to receive the sacrament frequently?
First, both the command and the promise of Christ the Lord. Second, his own pressing need, because of which the command, encouragement, and promise are given.
But what should you do if you are not aware of this need and have no hunger and thirst for the sacrament?
To such a person, no better advice can be given than this. First, he should touch his body to see if he still has flesh and blood. Then he should believe what the scriptures say of it in Galatians 5 and Romans 7. Second, he should look around to see whether he is still in the world, and remember that there will be no lack of sin and trouble, as the scriptures say in John 15 and 16, and in 1 John 2 and 5. Third, he will certainly have the devil also around him, who, with his lying and murdering day and night, will let him have no peace within or without, as the scriptures picture him in John 8 and 16, 1 Peter 5, Ephesians 6, and 2 Timothy 2.
These questions and answers are no child's play, but are drawn up with great earnestness of purpose by the venerable and devout Dr. Luther for both young and old. Let each one pay attention and consider it a serious matter, for St. Paul writes to the Galatians in chapter 6, "Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked." We pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing unto thee, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. The basis for our sermon this morning is that from the epistle reading, but in particular just that last verse, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So how is it that we are to understand the world? Do we develop a framework, if you will, by which we can understand it? Do we figure out our own way? Or do we perhaps let God define things for us? And do we let him show us how to understand our situation and how we are to live in this world? The Bible itself is actually a very clear book. There's no secrets to understanding it, and there's no way that you have to try to unlock the key, per se. But the reasons that people come around with different understandings is because they try to interpret it from their own experience, from their own perspective, from using other things in the world rather than simply believing. For the Bible itself is clear. But we as human beings are not. What God says in the Bible is plain. The problem is we don't like it. We don't like what God thinks, what God says. But he does say through the prophet Isaiah, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." It's not that we cannot know God's thoughts, that for he gives them to us right there in the scriptures. Because there we read them. There we can know what God thinks, what God says. It's just that we disagree with them. This is the reason for the many interpretations of God's clear biblical teaching. Folks disagree with God who doesn't think like they do. People disagree with God on the consequences of their own sin. He says the wages of sin is death. People hear what God says, they understand it, but they reject it. They think that they may do as they please, that they might do that without any kind of consequences, that they may sin according to God's word without repercussion. They think that since they can make excuses, that they can change the subject, that they can point the finger at others and in other creative ways avoid confronting their own sin, that somehow those sins don't have to be paid for. That there's no wages that are due, but they are wrong. What God says goes. They all die. They all face judgment. People disagree with God. They disagree with God on how it is that one gets into heaven. They think that the road to heaven is paved with their own good deeds. They ascribe this opinion then also to God. They think this is what he ought to say. He says, though, that the gift of God is eternal life. They hear what he says and they assume that he cannot mean it. So they try to figure out a way to change the plan, to somehow construe those words to give God's words a different meaning so that they will teach what they have already decided that God must think. Before they even heard what God said. The reason people reject God and what God says in the Bible is not that God doesn't clearly say it. It's that they elevate their own reason. They elevate their own feelings. They elevate their own ability to think, their experiences in life above what God clearly says. They think that they are a Bible-believing person, a Bible-believing Christian even, but they reject what the Bible clearly says. This is why people deny that babies are born again in holy baptism, that the bread and the wine and the Lord's Supper truly is the body and blood of Jesus Christ, and that a man can speak words of forgiveness, and that it's just as true in heaven as it is on earth. The Bible teaches these things, but folks just can't understand how they can be true. And because they can't understand it, they deny it. You know, there's no secret to the understanding the Bible. There's no key to unlock everything. The Bible itself provides us, though, with the framework. A key, if you will. It teaches us both God's law and his gospel. So the key then to understanding the Bible is to distinguish between these two things, to distinguish between the law and the gospel. You know, as we think about them, as we contemplate them and we read them in the scriptures, we think that they contradict each other. We think that this apparent contradiction runs throughout the whole scriptures. And I say apparent because it only appears to be a contradiction with each other. God is the author of the Bible, and God himself cannot contradict himself. The Bible teaches both law and gospel. The law is the teaching that we must love God, and it teaches us that we must love him. That we must love him with our entire being, our whole heart, soul, and mind, but then also that we must love our neighbor, even as ourselves. The law is summarized for us in the Decalogue, the Ten Commandments. The law is good. It is from God. It promises God's blessings to all people who do it. And it condemns to hell everyone who disobeys it. The gospel is the teaching that God, for Christ's sake, though, freely forgives all of our sins, every sin that we commit against his law. The gospel does not tell us what we must do. It points us to what Christ himself has already done for us. He is the one that has obeyed the law and done so perfectly. He is the one that has suffered upon the cross and done so in our place on account of our disobedience to the law. The gospel gives us exactly what it promises. It tells us that our sins are forgiven for Christ's sake, and so they are. The gospel is good, too. It is from God. It promises God's blessings to everyone who believes it. And it gives us then that gift of eternal life. God teaches us both the law and the gospel. And we need to hear both. We need to hear both of these teachings. We need to hear the law because without it we would not come to know our own sin. And unless we know our own sin, we do not understand our need for a Savior. One reason people think that Christ's death on the cross is not important to them is because they don't read the law. They don't understand their own sin. They don't think that they sin and therefore don't need any kind of Savior like that. But St. Paul writes that the law, though, is our tutor. And it is there to direct us to Christ, that we may be justified then through faith in him. The law shows us that we cannot find our way to God. It definitively tells us that we need a Savior. But we also need to hear that gospel because it is the means by which the Holy Spirit works faith in our hearts. As he directs us through the Bible's teaching that we do have a Savior. And as we have been convicted by that sin, he then turns our gaze, if you will, away from that sin to the one who has borne that sin. That's why we preach it. That's why we confess it. It's why we teach it and we support its constant proclamation. The greatest gift that anyone can give is that gospel, because the gospel itself gives eternal life. Now, some people, they reject the Christian faith after suffering, let's say, the loss of a child and under tragic circumstances. How could a king, how could a loving God permit such a thing, they ask. But when St. Paul writes that the wages of sin is death, he is not ascribing to God cruelty, for God himself is kind, he is loving. God is full of mercy. But as the scriptures tell us, the wages of sin is death. And so we understand people don't die because they are without sin. They die because They are sinners. They possess sin. Sin isn't God's fault. He didn't create us as sinful. He created us in His own image. He created us to know Him and to love Him, to actually be like He is. Sin comes from ignoring God's word. It comes from trusting lies that do not come from God. In our text today, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Comes from a portion of St. Paul's letter here to the Romans, where he confronts a very common challenge, a challenge to the gospel, that if the forgiveness of sins and eternal life are freely given, then somehow we must think that we are given the encouragement to simply disobey the law. And nobody understands, or nobody who understands sin, though, would make such an argument. Sin isn't stuff that you get to do. Sin is what kills you, as Paul writes. It isn't freedom to do as one pleases. It is, as Paul writes, a slavery to one's own fleshly passions. Our text for today, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. A clear distinction. That which kills is the sin, but that which gives life is God's gift. Our bodies are gifts from God. The giver of the gift knows how the gift is to be used as well. To abuse one's body by engaging in those things that St. Paul would list, such as sexual immorality and gluttony and drunkenness and other such sins, is to keep our body enslaved. It is to continue to beat down ourselves, if you will, and keep it enslaved. Enslaved then to death. That's a vicious form of slavery. The more that one trusts in these things that pleasure the body, the more that one looks for them, the more one is left, though, unsatisfied. We can gain nothing by such a path. Instead, we would see our bodies only, as we do, get older, get weaker. We see death approach so that the wages of sin would be paid. The hymnist writes for us, "Death, dost pursue me all the way. Nowhere I rest securely. He comes by night, he comes by day, and takes his prey most surely. A failing breath and I in death's strong grasp may lie. To face eternity today, death doth pursue me all the way." There is that saying that only the good die young. That is a lie. The good don't die. They live forever. It is only sinners who die. What does God's word say? It says that God breathed into Adam's nostrils the breath of life. It was not the breath of death. Adam did not become a dying soul, but he became rather a living soul. God is good and he is immortal. He does not die. Only sinners die. This is why the death of Jesus for us is such a wonderful event. It couldn't have been for his own sin that he died, because he himself committed no sin. It was for our sins that he bore that cross. It was for our sins that he died. He paid the wages of our sin with his own innocent life. He doesn't give us what he didn't first earn. He earned it, and so we see that life itself is not cheap. Life is very expensive. The purchase price for our lives was the very blood of God's only begotten Son. The gift of life, as Paul writes, is eternal life, or the gift of God is eternal life. But we don't stop there. That gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. It was the Lord who earned that gift for us. The Lord God Almighty, who became man for us. It is He who has given His life. It is He who gave His life to pay for all of sin's wages. He had not given His life up as the offering. Had He not done so as the offering for sins, He would not have had eternal life to give us. He purchased what He gives to us. St. Paul tells the pastor in Ephesus to feed the church of God, which He purchased with His own blood. That is God's blood. God's incarnate life given into death is the price that has already been paid. But you cannot buy it. I cannot buy it. None in this world can buy it. To try to pay for what Christ has already bought you is an insult to God. It is an insult to His Son. It is to deny who He is and what He has done for us. So don't offer God your promises to do better. Don't offer God anything that you have. But take what He gives you. Yield what He has taken from you, your sins, and receive what He gives you, the forgiveness and life eternal. Believe Him when He tells you that as far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed your sins from you. Believe Him when He tells you that the body and the blood that you eat and you drink in the sacrament of the altar, that they take away your sins and they give you eternal life. We do need the law to keep us in line, though, as well. Law and order is just not just a slogan, if you will, for society or for politicians. It is necessary for us to live here in peace in this world. We need the law to show us our sin. Until we know what we deserve from God because of our sins, we will not know why Jesus had to die for us. And we will not know that we need Him as our Savior. Our Savior from those sins and from death. We need the law to show us right from wrong as well. How to please God. How to act as a Christian in this fallen world. And thereby do the things that God desires of us. We need God's law. And without it, we would only descend into savagery as a society. And as aimless Christians. Without His guidance. But it is not that law that makes us righteous, as St. Paul writes. In chapter 3 of Romans, he writes, "Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and that all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in His sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin." Jesus earned, though, the gift of eternal life for us, and by His holy obedience and sacrificial death. And God gives that gift of eternal life to us in the gospel, as it is proclaimed and as it is administered in the sacraments. We receive the gift of eternal life through faith in these things. These temporal means, we trust the word spoken, we trust the gift given. We say amen to God's law when it condemns us for our sins, and we say amen to God's gospel as it rescues us from those sins. We don't trust in the law, but we believe it. We believe the gospel. And we do trust it. The promises of the law They do depend on us, but that promise of the gospel, it depends only on Jesus. He is our Savior, and we are not. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Upon our prayer list, all that are in our hearts, those whom we love,
everyone who is cared for and for all who care for them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mercy arms of the church, that in these times of trouble, the church would have opportunity and would not hesitate in caring for those around them, but instead would do all within her power to show mercy, even as her Lord has shown mercy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
On this day, when the Lutheran Church of the Resurrection in Waterville receives her new pastor, that God will bless both congregation and pastor, Ben Akers, his family, as they settle into Waterville, that the ministry there would be fruitful in the years to come, that it would be bold before the world according to God's will. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O God, because your abiding presence always goes with us, keep us aware of your daily mercies, that we may live secure and content in your eternal love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
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 The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you.
Amen.
Amen. Limited capacity so that we can maintain our spacing and so forth. All of the information is on our website, so if you go to redeemermaine.org, you can find that information. Follow the COVID-19 instructions, and it'll take you through a number of things to read and the opportunity to sign up for the services and sign up Genius. And if you have any questions at all, don't hesitate to call me. I'll explain it to everybody once or twice through, just to make sure everybody knows how it's working. I think many people are already familiar. And I was glad when they said, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Thanks be to God. God bless all of you.
Amen.